thanks everyone for being here, and many thanks to Oneida for giving me the opportunity to speak here, not just because it gets me away from New York City weather for a couple of days, but also because it's my first time here, and I've been pretty blown away by the size and the scope of the Oneida convention. So I've got to say that you guys really know how to throw a party, so it's going back way for you. So autonomous cars, I'm pretty sure, you know, when many of you saw this topic, you know, there's probably a little bit of eye rolling, a little bit of skepticism, you know, as to why we're discussing this here, because this still clearly sounds like science fiction. But what I'm hoping you leave here with is a sense of autonomous cars are real. They're going to probably be here sooner than you think. And the implications of having these cars on our roads are pretty profound. Let's just start with talking about the socioeconomic implications. So an autonomous car obviously is a car that can drive itself from point A to point B with no input from the driver whatsoever. So the driver could be reading a book, if anyone reads books anymore, or surfing the internet, you know, having breakfast, or even sleeping, and the car just gets from point A to point B. In fact, you don't even need to have someone in the car. So the practical benefits of something like this are pretty obvious. Obviously, commutes to work can be much less stressful. The young and the old significantly improve their mobility. And particularly relevant in a town like New Orleans, you can have as many beers you want at the bar because the car's going to drive you home. But what we tried to do was try to estimate the economic benefits of these practical implications. And this is what we ended up with. $1.3 trillion. We estimate that the US economy alone can save $1.3 trillion if all the cars on the road drove themselves. How do we get there? About $150 billion comes from fuel savings alone. This is the easiest and the most scientific bucket to prove out. Again, when you guys go home tomorrow, do your morning commute using cruise control the majority of the time, and try the same thing the next day driving manually. I mean, it's been empirically proven that you can improve your fuel efficiency by 15 to 30% by using cruise control alone. An autonomous car is on cruise control 100% of the time. So you apply that to how much people drive in the US, that gets you over $150 billion. Another $150 billion comes from congestion avoidance. Now, one of the top causes of congestion is when the light turns green, the car at the head of the line kind of takes a few seconds to pull away, unless you're in New Jersey, or the car behind you is honking and the light even changes. But once the cars have pulled away, there's another few seconds, another few seconds, so you have that accordion effect of traffic, which leads to a lot of congestion. This won't happen in the case of autonomous cars, because they know exactly when the light's going to turn, and they leave at the same time. So both from the fuel efficiency savings from congestion avoidance, as well as the productivity gains, because you can now get to work sooner, or you can now get to where you're going sooner. That is another $150 billion. Seems like a big number, but that's enough. Another $500 billion comes from productivity in your car. I mean, the average American spends 75 to 100 billion hours in their car every year. Now, that's obviously a huge waste of time in which you can work, you can consume stuff, you can, you know, be entertained. If you quantify that, that's about $500 billion. And about $500 billion comes from accident savings. There are about 32,000 people killed on the roads in the US alone every year. And obviously, by some estimates, 90% of crashes are caused by human error. You take the human out of the driving equation, and you probably don't have these accidents. So that, again, is a lot of productivity you can give back to the economy. Now, this is the last bucket of accident avoidance is particularly relevant for emerging markets, where the rate of fatalities for 100,000 vehicles is about 25 to 75 times that of the US. And these are also the fastest growing markets in the world, so that rate of traffic fatalities, unfortunately, is only going to keep going up. So if, again, autonomous cars can change this, and again, they can stop these fatalities from happening and be a complete game changer. Now, it doesn't really matter if autonomous cars can theoretically be a game changer. I mean, time travel can be a game changer as well. The thing that's important to recognize is that the technology to enable autonomous cars is here already. Okay? The way autonomous cars work is in the exhibit on the right. The car is full of a battery of cameras and radar and sensors that creates a sensory buffer around the car and enables it to know where it's going on the road. You couple that with an large GPS system and communication with infrastructure and other cars around it, and the car can drive itself pretty accurately. Now, it's important to keep in mind that all the autonomous car is doing is taking active safety systems, things like lane departure warning or automatic braking or blind spot assistance, that's already available in cars today, in cars that you sell in your countries and in the US, and takes it to a higher level of capability. So this technology is on the road today at a very basic level. Now, what happens is, once you take the driver out of the equation, you need to replace him with an electronic or software driver that does the driving functions, right? So we call that a domain controller, and that's that big yellow box that's in the center of the car. What the domain controller is, it's basically a software electronic component that takes the input from the cameras. So suppose the camera detects there's something lying on the road in front of the car, about 100 meters on the road, okay? The domain controller will read that image, determine is that object static or is it moving, how large is it, and does the car need, can it drive over it, does it need to change lanes, or does it need an emergency brake? So it crosses these things, and it decides one of the three courses of action, right? So that's the second stage, the second function of the autonomous car, the domain controller. And then once it decides what to do, it sends a message to the mechanical components of the car, things like the steering wheel, the turn signals, the brakes, and using mechanical actuators actually gets the car to do what it's doing. So what you're seeing here is that domain controller is going to become the most important component of the car going forward, and whoever controls that domain controller is probably going to contribute most of the value of the car. Now again, this may sound like science fiction, but a very basic version of this is already in cars today, and a fully-fledged autonomous version of this is in prototypes of cars made by Mercedes, Audi, BMW, and of course Google that are on our streets today. Now, the advanced nature of the technology gives us confidence that this is going to be on the road sooner than you think. Okay, and we put together this adoption curve. Passive autonomous driving, like I said, active safety is already in cars today. Limited driver substitution is phase two, and what limited driver substitution is that the car can be fully autonomous, but only under certain situations. So either in traffic jams only, or on highways only. And we think that's gonna be here 18 to 24 months from now. Now again, that sounds aggressive until you keep in mind that the 2014 Mercedes-Benz S-Class that actually went on sale 3 months ago already has this technology on the road today. So we think it becomes more widespread over the next 18, 24 months. We think you can buy a fully autonomous car that can drive itself under most circumstances by the end of the decade. So again, within the next 5 to 6 years, you'll be able to buy these cars. Now again, I'm talking about new vehicle availability. By the time every car on the road has self-driving capability, that's probably gonna take 2 or 3 decades at a rate of natural penetration. Now, before we get all excited about this, I'd like to address 2 or 3 topics that keep being presented to us as obstacles or insurmountable hurdles that prevent the penetration of autonomous cars. And I'd like to address a few of them. One is consumer awareness. People say that you can take a steering wheel and like hold their hands. I've been really surprised at how many people who have come out, you know, after we started discussing this topic, to say, I really love driving, I don't want to stop driving anymore. But at the end of the day, commuting is a really painful chore, and most people would love to take the commute on their hands. Okay? We think that consumer awareness can build because this is not an overnight transition. You're not going to go from a manually driven car to an autonomous car overnight. What's going to happen is people are going to get used to the active safety features. For example, when I have a car with adaptive cruise control, when I use it the first time, I freaked out. But after using 4 or 5 times, when I realized I'm not crashing, I got a lot more comfortable with it, and now I probably can't drive without it. So as people get used to these systems, we think they'll be more comfortable giving up incrementally more control of the car to the car itself. The second issue is regulatory support. How do we get the government on board with this? Because the government usually tends to be a decade late, $1 billion short when it comes to most initiatives. The good news is that right now the government doesn't need to do anything. In the US at least, autonomous cars are completely legal to drive on roads because there's nothing that says that they're illegal. So we can get the initial autonomous cars on the roads today. Maybe 5 to 10 years from now, we think the government can actually accelerate the adoption Because if you're even remotely right about that $1.3 trillion, the government or Washington will want to get this thing on the road as soon as possible. And we think that they can help penetration either through use of mandates or a strap-in scheme or something. But right now, the government is not the obstacle. The third and most and the most frequent issue we come across is the liability issue. Right? What happens if an autonomous car crashes? Who is responsible for the crash? Now, again, we actually think that this is a pretty easy corollary to cross for two reasons. Number one, if all the states in the US went to no-fault states, there are already 12 states in the US that are no-fault, meaning there's an accident, it doesn't matter who caused it, both of them are equally liable for insurance. If all the states went to no-fault states, we think that we don't need to answer the question of who caused the accident for insurance purposes. For criminal purposes, of course, we still need to know who caused the accident. But keep in mind that an autonomous car is going to be stuffed full of cameras and sensors and radar and black boxes. So accident reconstruction is going to be really, really easy. In fact, we think that there can be an accident report on the dashboard of the car even before the first police car shows up. So we don't think the liability issue is going to be a huge deal. In fact, we've spoken with a number of people in regulatory bodies and the insurance industry who think that the liability issue can be resolved fairly easily. In terms of network infrastructure, I think that is probably the biggest deal. Again, we don't need to have cars that communicate with each other and with the infrastructure for the first cars to go on the road, but when 100% of cars are self-driving, we probably need that infrastructure. The good thing is that the telecom guys and people like AT&T and Verizon get this, and they're pretty excited about this, and they're working pretty hard to get this on the road today. So, what autonomous cars are going to do is, look, this is not just a cool new feature like, you know, LED lights or an infotainment system that's on a car. We think that the impact is going to be pretty profound. I mean, the first leg is, we think that the car of tomorrow is going to look very different from the car of today. Okay? Again, with the domain controller, once you replace the driver, the level of software in the car goes up exponentially. Again, this is the software needed to both drive the car and also the content within the car itself, because the occupants of the car now have nothing to do. So there's a lot of TV and surfing and whatever it is they do that they can do. So what happens is that the car of today, which is primarily a hardware device, goes to being a predominantly software device over time. Now, keep in mind that what also happens is that the traditional auto industry is going to see a pretty major shakeup, because the traditional OEMs today are very good hardware makers. They design and they assemble cars, but they're not really good at software. So once you take the value of the hardware, what it is that they do very well, and take that from being 90% of the car to being 40% of the car, the value that the OEMs provide goes down significantly. So that's the left pie chart of this Venn diagram. We think that the auto industry is going to look a lot like the PC or smartphone industry going forward, where the traditional OEMs can be like the HPs or the Dells of the world, become primarily hardware providers, and that's a very different business than we know today. It's a very cost-sensitive business. Brands are not very important. So they don't do different things to be successful in a hardware-only world. On the other hand, you have software providers, you know, people who provide the operating system or the self-driving car system, the automotive suppliers, the Googles of the world, who come out there and license their systems to the OEMs. And we could see Google potentially make the Android of cars, where they give the OEM the self-driving car system for free in exchange for the data or controlling the content within the car. So this is a completely new space within the industry. And the third, and what we can also see is the space in the center, which is the experience guys, people who want to be Apple of the automotive world, OEMs who want to design the best car, build the best car, have the best and safest self-driving system, the best dealership network, and just be the best end-to-end experience. So again, we think that this auto industry of the future is going to look a lot like PCs or smartphones of today. Again, this chart's difficult to read, but what this tells you is that the implications are not only profound for the auto industry, but for many other industries as well. For example, media. If you're now going to be consuming media for the 100 billion hours you spend in a car, that's a $10 billion revenue opportunity for them. For the telecom equipment guys, it's about a $100 billion opportunity for them. For freight transportation, self-driving trucks can significantly save the operator's costs That's about $165 billion revenue opportunity for them. These are fairly conservative numbers in our book. For automotive dealers, right? What's the dealer? What are the implications of this for dealers? On the one hand, these cars are going to be so sophisticated that the cars will have to be serviced at dealers, no questions asked. On the other hand, if the cars are crashing a lot less frequently and they're being driven really well, then there may be fewer things to fix. Again, on the one hand, automotive ownership can go up significantly, and that will be great for car sales. On the other hand, if people are all just driving and self-driving cars and people don't have to own their cars anymore, that could impact automotive ownership. So again, many polar opposite scenarios for the dealerships, and many extreme scenarios. Well, let's conclude by saying that what we are trying to say is that this is a very real scenario, a very real opportunity, a threat for some people. And we need to start discussing this today, because with the 10-year development cycle in the auto industry, by the time these cars actually hit the road, because the technology is already there, we just need to solve some practical issues to get these cars.